Good evening, everyone, and welcome to NLL Live for Week 8. I'm your host, Mark Powers. With me, as always, the editor of Lacrosse All-Stars, one of my best buds, Connor Wilson. How you doing tonight?
I'm doing well. I'd complain about the weather, but we've got a guest from Calgary on.
That's right. Obviously, one of the coldest places in North America. Let's cut to it. We got the leading goal scorer from the WLA last year, one of the emerging superstars in the NLL, and a guy that we're hoping to see grace us this summer out in Denver playing for Team Canada. Curtis Dixon, how you doing tonight?
Fantastic. Thanks for having me, gentlemen.
Yeah, great to have you on. I'm actually excited to talk to you. You're a an emerging goal scorer both in the indoor league and the outdoor league. Is there one that you favor over the other?
I'd have to say box cross just because I've played it for pretty much my whole life growing up since I was about 3 years old. A little bit faster pace, which is more my style. So if I had to pick one, I'd say box.
Excellent. And before we get into our lightning round, I just want we've actually renamed it this week. I apologize. No longer is it the lightning round. We're calling it the icebreaker, and we've named it that, hoping to loosen you up a little bit, Curtis, ask you some softball questions, get to know you a little bit before we take some questions from the viewers. And that's a reminder to everyone, you can get at us via Twitter, via Facebook. Obviously, you can leave a comment here on the YouTube feed. Curtis is looking forward to answering them, so please get those in. But let's start our icebreaker off, and let's start with a relatively easy one. What's your favorite what's your favorite non-lacrosse team?
I'm an Edmonton Oilers fan, actually. Hockey.
Excellent, excellent.
And, unfortunately. What's
been your favorite sport that you've been watching so far in the Olympics?
I guess the obvious answer is hockey.
Right.
But, watching that skeleton where they're going down those tracks head first at about 200 miles an hour is pretty exciting as well.
Sure, sure. do you have a specific food that you got to eat for pregame?
Just the cliche, chicken and pasta is usually the go-to. That's what they feed us. The team feeds us for a home game, so that's usually what it is.
I got a one-word response. It's going to be a visual question, though, for you, so get your eyes peeled. What do you have to say about that?
Actually, I played my last year in junior. I was a 7-belly. So I can't, and my dad was a belly playing senior, won a man cup there, so I can't hate too much.
There you go. So good things.
Yeah, definitely.
That's excellent. That's really excellent. Speaking of the WLA, what's your favorite on-floor memory, and then tell me what your favorite on-field memory is from either playing NCAA or outdoor professional lacrosse?
On-floor memory, I haven't had a ton of success in the indoor game, unfortunately, so...
You scored, 103 goals last year? I think you're having a little success.
Yeah, personally, yeah.
17 games, yeah?
Yeah, I mean, scoring all those goals last year was definitely a lot of fun, but our team didn't do too well, unfortunately. We missed out on our playoffs, but as far as field, I'd probably have to say playing in the Final Four my freshman year at Delaware. I still think it's one of, if not the most highly attended games in lacrosse history. There's 52,000-plus people there, so... And getting to play in that and actually having a chance to score a goal there, too, was pretty pretty memorable.
Yeah, no question. You guys were a really compelling story that year. I think I speak for Connor in saying that we both like watching you guys. Obviously, that was a team with Alex Smith. You guys had tons of possessions, played a really compelling style. And hopefully we see a return to that for the Blue Hens this year. A couple more questions for you. Who's been the person that's had the most impact on your career?
I have to say my dad. He got a stick in my hands when I was 3 years old, got me playing mini tyke, which is the first year of box lacrosse. I think he managed to squeeze me in a year before everybody else. He knew a guy. So, without him going down to the box with me, playing wall ball in the basement every other day, he's been a huge influence for me. I definitely owe everything to him.
That's awesome. You always got to know a guy, right?
Exactly.
So another softball for you. What's your favorite movie and your favorite TV show?
Movie, all time, I'm going to have to go with Zoolander, classic.
Nice.
And TV show, I'm going to have to, between Modern Family and Breaking Bad.
Two good choices.
I've been sitting on two episodes left in Breaking Bad for about 2 weeks now. I'm just too depressed to watch them. I don't want it to end, so.
Right. Okay. I'm there with you. I'm not at the finale yet either, so no spoilers coming, right?
No, you bet.
What's been your favorite non-lacrosse job, if you've had one?
My mom works at the Coliseum back home. It's where the WHL team and the Canucks used to play. And I was bartending there for a bit. And bartending's definitely a pretty fun, different job.
I'm sure, especially at an arena. That sounds like a good deal.
Yeah. So, run into some interesting people, that's for sure.
Yeah. So that leads to my next little question for you here. Do you have any nicknames, maybe some that you earned at the bar? Or maybe if you don't have one, you tell us a good one that you gave out to someone else.
No, I was never given any nicknames at the bar. Dicker, pretty much cliche. Just taking something from your last name has been my nicknames growing up. And no, just maybe Drunky, given to other people at the bar.
Gotcha, okay. Well, I was in doing my research, I saw some people that are looking to coin you Superman because of all your diving attempts on the cage. Any comments on that? Are you looking to make that moniker stick?
Yeah, I mean, that's pretty cool. Obviously, as long as everybody knows it's not self-proclaimed.
Sure.
So it's definitely cool to be named after a superhero, so it's definitely something I'll try and run with.
Nice. Here's an interesting question for you. If you could have lunch with one person, dead or alive, who would it be?
Ooh, that is an interesting question. Let's go with Muhammad Ali. He'd be pretty cool.
Excellent. He seems like a pretty common choice, and I think I understand why. He's a great athlete. Mm-hmm. Here's an interesting one for you that's more focused on the league that you're playing in now, the NLL. If you could change one thing in the league, and obviously this is a league that's gone through a bunch of change recently, so maybe this isn't the best question, but if you could change one thing in the league, what would it be?
Oh, boy. Can I say we take out the crease rule?
Entirely?
No, I'm just kidding. That obviously wouldn't happen. I don't know. Maybe better camera angles, better quality cameras just for challenges and stuff. There's always gray areas. Some of the arenas aren't as up to par in the tech department, and so it's tough, but maybe that. I don't know. Other than that, I think things are run pretty smoothly this year.
That's reasonable. That's pretty diplomatic of you. So that's good. That's the don't get fired quote right there.
Exactly.
That is excellent. So let's get back to lacrosse a little bit. This is the question that Connor loads every time, but I have to ask it. Any memorable fights that you've been involved in?
Oh, I'm not much of a fighter. I don't have any fights in my NHL career yet, but had a couple good fights with Matt Beers from Vancouver in junior. So
okay.
Other than that, obviously, like I said, I've maybe been in a couple other fights, so I'd say those two were standout.
Excellent. And last one from me, what's the most memorable goal you scored indoor and the most memorable goal you scored outdoors?
Ooh, that's a good question. Indoors, like I said, I haven't played in too many important games in my indoor career, but last year, 0-2 winner against Colorado was pretty cool, getting to score a goal like that. Outdoor, might have to go back to the Final Four again, just getting to play on that stage and score a big goal. Being a freshman, 18 years old, was a pretty cool experience.
Yeah, I can only imagine, man. That sounds awesome.
I'm going to ask you one smart guy question. What's the last book you read?
Ooh, that is a good one. The Iceman. You guys heard of that one? Richard Kuklinski. It's about a mafia hitman.
Yes, yes.
Do you want to give us like a 30 to 40 minute synopsis?
On the spot, go.
Let me get the back of the book and read that for you.
Well, the juxtaposition of the protagonist with you can spare us. You can spare us.
Yeah, I don't want to bore you.
Thank you. All right, so let's That was a great icebreaker, Curtis. It was great to meet you. And soon we're going to transition to our viewer questions. I see we got some great ones coming in. And shout out to Mark Matthews, who's watching tonight. We got a lot of other NLL fans. We got We do have one person. We got to get to this one. Throne of String has a great question. They want to know, is that Connor Wilson or Ethan Iannucci? I mean, what's the deal with the beard, bud? Are we letting it roll?
Yeah, man. Not going anywhere. I'm helping out again with a high school team here in Brooklyn, and if they win a city championship, I'll let them shave my beard. But until then, I think it's sticking around for the long haul.
Whoa, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, that's big talk. I like that.
I'm trying to get on Nuch's level, you know.
Yeah, that thing does look pretty fierce. Curtis, is that something you get involved in? You see, Connor and I both have beards. I know that's a big thing in the NLL. Are you a beard guy?
Yeah, just more has to do with being lazy for me.
Yeah, I agree.
Just not getting around to it, but no. If I have a couple bad games in a row, I'll always shave. A little superstitious like that. So, and if I'm having success, I'll let it go. So.
Nice. I agree with that. That's the way to be. Let it go until you need a change.
Exactly.
But let's get back to talking about the league a little bit. Connor, why don't you take us through the scores from last week? We had a bunch of teams in action. We had some more close games and some surprising results. Walk me through what we had.
Sure. We had one game go down on February 7th with The Rock doubling up the Philly Wings 20-10. That was a kind of a statement game, I think, for The Rock a little bit, especially with Philly looking better this year. And then the next day, Philly again back in action, playing a really different style team, again losing, unfortunately, for the Wings, 8-6 to the Edmonton Rush. It's two tough teams to play, you know, back-to-back days. Buffalo and Rochester, you know, it did kind of live up to the hype. Rochester won 9-6, so they've now evened that series at 1-1 for the year, which is, you know, looking like the battle for the top of the East Coast, East Division at least, anyways. Mm-hmm. Calgary took down Minnesota 15-13. We're obviously going to talk with Curtis more about that. And Colorado taking down Vancouver 10-9. Vancouver a little bit of a surprise as the doormat, or at least at this point, but I'm sure we'll get to that later.
Yeah, and let's talk about some of the other games first before we let Curtis get in on the conversation a little bit more. Liked what I saw out of Philly, even though they lost. What do you think about that?
Yeah, no, I mean, you know, they are playing their style of lacrosse this year, which is different from what they've done in years past. They've got a new cast of characters, at times a rotating cast of characters, you know, but it's guys who can get the job done. So I think if they find a little more consistency, you know, the wins can start to come for them. Games do, you know, can get away from you from time to time, and I think that's what happened in Toronto, you know, to lose by 10 goals. But to come back the next night and play a top-flight team relatively close, you know, I think that says something about, you know, kind of the makeup of that squad.
Yeah, that's what I was getting at. I was definitely way more impressed by the back end of their two games against Edmonton, who's really been taking it to everybody. I mean, I'm not surprised that they won, but impressed that Philly kept it close after getting blown out the night before. Got a shout out to Gary Billings in that game. He's been going off the past couple weeks, as has our guest, but Mr. Billings in particular is killing it right now. I talked about adding him to my fantasy team a couple weeks ago, and regrettably I've yet to make the move, so I'm kind of kicking myself on that. He had, what was it, 9 points again this weekend, scored some really sick goals, and reminded everybody, check out the top 10 for the NLL Plays of the Week. You can find that on the Lacrosse Network. That's a great set. This week's plays were, again, spectacular. Toronto looked great. You know, it was good to see them score a bunch of goals, open up the offense. Connor, I know you like that team. I think that they're in a good position coming down the stretch, maybe a little bit better than we thought in the East. You know, last week we were talking about who would be that last spot, and now you saw Toronto and Philly, the teams that we thought would be jockeying for it. They had a head-to-head, and, man, Toronto came out, you know, big.
Yeah, I mean, they certainly benefit from that, but again, you know, they're only a game ahead of Philadelphia. So, you know, one or two games here and there can really switch things up. And as we've seen, you know, sometimes teams have bad weekends. So, you know, at this point in the season, I think everybody has played between 6 and 8 games. So we kind of have a slightly more accurate litmus test. I think we're at a good check-in point for where teams are at. And, you know, Minnesota right now is the only one looking like they're on the outside to me.
Yeah. Yeah, agreed. And unfortunate considering that I had them as the number one team in the preseason. Going to be kicking myself for that for a long time. Thanks, Minnesota. But before we transition to talking about the Western Conference, I do want to talk about Rochester. And more specifically, I want to talk about Rochester's defense. I don't know the stats well enough to be able to talk intelligently about NLL defenses and how they're ranked all time. But to me, this defense has been spectacular. Matt Vince is obviously killing it. And in an era where we're so focused on transition and on offense, you're really seeing some incredible play out of the Rochester defense. What do you think about what you've seen, and who's really impressed you?
I mean, obviously, you know, when we're going to talk about the West, we'll talk about Edmonton. You know, they've played six games, and they've only given up 45 goals in those six games. Mm-hmm. Rochester, also having played six games with a 4-2 mark, has only given up 48 goals. Which is, you know, really amazing because I think everybody kind of looked at Edmonton as being that top defense. You know, for me, the problem with Rochester really right now is they have an awful lot of talent that plays together consistently. You know, these guys know each other at this point. And for them to only be averaging, you know, a shade under 10 goals a game, and they've got 59 goals in six games, you know, that's a little surprising. I know that they don't get necessarily as many touches or transition opportunities, but I do think that that offense is going to need to kind of pull together and continue to improve if they want to really make a run at a third title.
You're right, and that's really great insight. I agree. I think kind of like Edmonton, although Edmonton's doing it way better, and you're really seeing them have an offensive explosion this year, and I think that Rochester's got to do the same thing to match their stellar defense. But let's talk about a conference that, you know, doesn't seem to be lacking for scoring, specifically the West. And we started the game with Colorado. They're on a little bit of a hot streak. They went out to the Langley Event Center and took down the Stealth. Not much of a surprise there. I didn't think it was necessarily going to be this close. I was really pleased with the, you know, what I saw out of Colorado going into it. You know, what did you think out of what you saw out of that game? I didn't get a chance to see it, but I did see the highlights.
Well, yeah, I mean, you know, Colorado is a team who just, you know, they have a number of guys who you know can get it done. You know, and I think people were a little surprised to see them struggle as much as they did. So this is, you know, sort of a vindication. You know, I think actually they are on the outside. They played the most games in the NLL right now. They're 4-5. So they played nine games. So, you know, so they're a bit of an outlier. But honestly, for them to be nine games into the season with kind of all the changeover, a little bit of injury bug here and there, you know, for them to be sitting at 4-5, sure, they're 3.5 games back from first place, but they're only half a game back from Calgary. So, you know, that puts them in a really good spot, and, you know, you can't really count out Vancouver either because, you know, they're really kind of right there.
Sure. But let's talk about Calgary, actually. Let's let my man Curtis back into the conversation a little bit. They had a really impressive win over the Swarm, like I said, a team that I had ranked really high. I was happy to see Calgary have a little bit of an explosion, get off of the schneid that they were experiencing recently. Curtis, talk to us about the game, man. How did it feel, and what did you think playing the Swarm this weekend?
It was good. You know, like you said, it's obviously nice to get a win. Big difference between 2-4 and 3-3. So being able to go into Mini, which isn't always an easy place to play against a scrappy Swarm team, it's always nice to, you know, go in there and squeak out a win. You know, we got up big there with about 10 minutes left in the fourth, and you know, you gotta know, with a team like Minnesota, you can never count them out, and they can string together goals like nobody else. So they put together a bit of a run at the end, but luckily we were able to hang on and get that win and get ourselves back to 500.
Sure. Now after the last loss you guys had before heading out to Minnesota, the captain McBride had mentioned that you guys have a little bit more discipline. Do you feel like you guys, you know, were able to bring that this game? Was that something tangible? You know, were you conscious of trying to do that? Especially you being a little bit of an undisciplined guy heading towards the net.
For sure. You know, you got to stay out of the box. That's the number one thing. You're not going to win many games being shorthanded most of the time. So, because we have, you know, our defensive numbers haven't been great so far this year, but I still think one of our defenses is one of the best 5-on-5 defenses in the league. And when you give them a chance to play 5-on-5, and let them show their stuff, we got a heck of a better chance to win. And same goes for our offense. You know, we're a great 5-on-5 team, And I think that's where we excel. So as long as we stay out of the box, I think the sky's the limit for us this year.
How do you guys go about, you know, forming that camaraderie and kind of that unity where you're willing to stay out of the box for each other and do these kind of things that will help your team win games? I mean, how do you form that specifically in Calgary? I mean, what's going on with you guys' franchise?
Yeah, I mean, at the end of the day, you just got to be able to look the guy next to you in the eye and tell him, you know, you gave everything you had. And if you're sitting in the box and the other team scores a big goal and kind of changes the tide of the game, it makes you feel like crap. So, you know, everyone's kind of been there. Everyone knows what that feeling's like. And it's just kind of something you got to think back on and learn from past experiences. And I think, like I said, we did a good job of righting the ship this week. And I don't think we took a ton of penalties. And it showed on the scoreboard.
Nice. That's excellent. And let's get to some of our viewer questions. Everybody, thanks for checking in. Really appreciate that. Shout out to at Claude Fegg. He says to our guest that he should stick with Superman as a nickname. Apparently that's going over well with everybody already. Matt Hawkins checked in. He wants to know, Curtis, what is your wall ball and shooting workout? Do you do anything specific?
You know what? When it comes to wall ball, it is what it is. You sit there, you throw the ball against the wall 100, 200, 300, 500 times. You know, especially the kids playing field lacrosse, do the two-hand thing. I never really was fortunate enough to pick up a stick playing field lacrosse till later in my high school days, so I didn't get to work on both hands as much, but it's definitely a good attribute to have. So obviously in the box game, you only use one hand, so you don't have to worry about too much there. But, you know, like I said, it's just repetition. Whether it's 100, 200, 500 times, just stick to it and try and get out there every day, every other day, or in the off season, just find a wall and throw the ball against it.
Yeah, no, I agree, and I apologize for laughing. I just got to Mark Matthews. Seems like he's got your number tonight. He's checking in. He's watching. He says he'd like to hear the story behind the hashtag Armed and Hammered T-shirt. I assume that might be an NSFW, as they say, right?
No, it's not bad. It's funny story. Long story short, we the Under Armour Team 22 guys, they take us to the Bahamas every year for a week, which is awesome. And we were at this gala ball the first year we went, and we were all decked out in tuxedos, and everyone's in ball gowns. And there's this one guy kind of sitting off in the corner, and he's got this Armed and Hammered T-shirt on with jeans. It's like the Arm and Hammer logo, but it's Armed and Hammered, and the guy's holding a bottle of beer. So, anyways, a year passes, and we go back the following year, which is this past November, and we see the same guy there, and I go up to him like, oh, you're the Armed and Hammered guy, like, we remember you from last year. He's like, oh, yeah, I still have the shirts in my room. So I went up, paid him $20, and I got the shirt sitting in my drawer right now. So
that is amazing.
He's legendary. He's legendary.
That's a good story. Mark, thank you for prying that out of Curtis. That's a good one. Nice. So we got a bunch of people checking in with some gear questions. I know you're affiliated with Team 22, Under Armour Lacrosse. You got the shirt on. You got your stick handy to show the people out there?
I sure do. I've been told I have one of the ugliest pockets in the league.
Uh-oh.
A nice low pocket.
By who?
Every teammate I've ever had.
Oh, all right.
I use a low pocket.
That's interesting. We haven't really seen too many low pockets in the box lacrosse, guys. You're going to have to explain that. And only two shooters. What is that? NCAA legal? What are you doing? You know, that's not Canadian.
This is kind of where it stemmed from. These are from my days at Delaware. This is how I kind of transformed into this. And, you know, I don't even remember what kind of stick I used before I went to school. So I've become an honorary American with this, with my low pocket. And I just never turned back. And I've just fallen in love with it. So I'm shunned by most Canadians now.
Connor is shocked, I know.
Well, no, I'm just curious, actually, if you could explain a little bit, because to me, you know, via this video, it looks like you have an absolute bag on that thing. Can you explain how that works? Because a lot of the kids who play field lacrosse who might be watching, you know, they've got these certain depth regulations. I mean, how do you, A, deal with the depth? What do you get from it, and how does it work for you in the box game?
I think being a lower pocket, it just looks like it's a bigger bag than it really is, because it's actually not that far off legal, like with the ball not being below the plastic. So, but I just like where the ball sits at the bottom of the pocket when you're cradling. If you have one hand, it sits there nicely, and the And, good for Reagan. Penalties, obviously, all won't come out as easily. But it is 100% NLL legal, so
yep.
Get that out there first.
Oh, but no, like, I think a lot of people...
The league is watching. That's important.
A lot of people think that, there are certain depth requirements, that you can't go too deep.
I think it just depends on the league. I know NLL, they don't have a depth requirement. But I know leagues like the MLL and obviously college ball, there is a certain depth you can go to. So it's all just catering to the rules. So that's what I'm doing.
Nice.
Does that change your game at all?
Sorry?
Does that change your game at all when you go from one set of rules to another and a different stick?
Like I said, mine's not far off legal, so it's not a huge deal. But there are obviously these adjustments, kind of just the way you have to throw the ball and the way you release it, if the pocket's deeper, shallower. So it's not, not the end of the world, but it is a little bit different.
Right. We got Matt Hawkins checking in with a gear related question. This is an interesting one. I'm not sure what your feelings on it are going to be, but I kind of have an inkling considering you're with Under Armour. What do you think about the recent MLL equipment additions with STX and Adrenaline? Should NLL do the same with other with the indoor league? Should they open it up to other sponsorship? And then he also asked, should the NLL and MLL work together? What are your thoughts on that interesting subject?
Well, as far as sponsorships go, I think everybody should be sponsored by Under Armour. They are the best league in the world, or the best gear in the world right now.
Good answer. And,
but as far as the leagues getting together and cooperating, I think that's a good idea. Obviously, with the overlap in the NLL and the MLL, it kind of stops some players from playing, like you see with the Americans this year. I don't know if that's due to the Worlds or due to the overlap, but it stops guys are in the middle of the NLL playoffs and the MLL starting up, so obviously some of the talent's not there for the start of the year at the MLL, so it's it kind of sucks to see that the leagues can't figure it out and kind of work together, but hopefully that's something they can figure out down the road.
Now tell us a little bit about your outdoor plans, because you've been teasing us a little bit recently with your performances for Team Canada at the duel in Denver. You come out every once in a while, you flash a little brilliance, but when are we going to have you in a full MLL season? What's the deal there?
It's a possibility for the summer. It's something I never completely rule out. It just has to do with timing and how my body's feeling and whatever else. So with the Worlds being this summer and me trying to crack that final roster for Team Canada, it's definitely in the cards for me to head out and play a little MLL this summer.
And that would be with Denver?
Yeah, Denver has my rights.
Okay.
We actually got a great reader question here, viewer question. Ryan Ballantyne, is this true? Are you the all-time leader in shorthanded goal for the Roughnecks?
I think last game I set the record. Yeah.
Well, congratulations on that. But
thank you.
He's actually got a fantastic follow-up question. I wish I could take credit for this and just steal it. But what's your secret to get so many shorthanded goals in such a short amount of time?
I'm surprised they have you on the kill.
Well, I got the big bag in my stick. It's tough to get the ball out. So
true.
I don't know. I just I got to give credit to teammates, obviously, playing with the offensive talent that I knew. They make life a lot easier for me. And I think I just, I take the ball hard to the net, whether it's, scoring goals or drawing the penalties to even it out. I think that's kind of what's helped me, being a bigger body and having the athleticism to do so. So I think that's kind of what's helped me so far in my young career.
Nice. And then kind of looking forward, would you be content? Would you be thrilled to stay in Calgary for your entire career? I mean, what do you think about moving around from franchise to franchise? Would you like to be a career franchise guy out for the Roughnecks?
I'd love to be a career franchise guy. There's, from what I hear around, there's no better place to play in Calgary. It's just great, and it's especially the Flames purchasing the team a few years ago. It's top notch, and I got a lot of friends on the team. It's close to home. I'm from Vancouver originally, so it's a a quick 1-hour flight home, and so it's like I said, it's a great place to play, and it's been a great place to play for my first 3 years of my career. It's been a great opening to the league for me.
Nice. Joshua Eric's curious, what kind of mesh you're using?
It's just generic soft mesh. I don't even know if it's name brand.
Oh, all right.
So there's nothing special about it.
We got thrown a string in the comments offering you some free mesh. So if you
want to inducements. Apparently, Doby likes it. They say you'll have to get some from Dane Doby.
There you go. Exactly.
Nice. Rumor on the street is. Yeah. And what do you think about living out in Calgary? I mean, you know, for some of our viewers who maybe haven't graced the city with their presence, you know, what do you think?
It's awesome. It's a beautiful city. Although, unlike you talked about earlier, it's a little chilly. It was minus 38 or something here a few days ago. It's been one of the worst winters, to date. To some of the guys I've talked to, lived here their whole lives. So, but other than that, it's actually a really nice city. And you know, coming from Vancouver, I'm used to the rain. So, like I said, I don't mind trading in the wet for the cold. It's a lot easier to stay warm than it is dry. So. It's a nice place, and especially having, you know, we got about 75% of the guys living here now on the team, so we're all a pretty tight-knit group, so it's fun having the guys. It's almost like being back at school.
That's awesome. That's great that they take care of you. Interesting question for you. You've played on some great teams out west, the New Westminster Salmon Bellies and the Maple Ridge Barards. What is up with these Canadian teams and these interesting names, and tell me, what is a Barard?
You know what? I'm going to be honest with you. I don't really know. I know it's they originated in Vancouver. I know there's a Burrard Street in Vancouver, but I don't know the whole history behind it. So, and I think Salmon Belly is pretty self-explanatory.
Right. Well, speaking of interesting teams, we got Nick Rose checking in. He's got an interesting thought. He wants to know, Curtis, have you ever thought about playing summer ball in Ontario? He says that he's heard Oakville is a great city for Superman to fly, so clearly the nickname is sticking.
Yeah, Rosie, he's a beauty. My heart's out west for now anyways. I've committed to Maple Ridge, and like I said, I might be trying out the MLL this summer and hopefully playing in the Worlds as well. So I think I'm sticking out west for now anyways, but never, like I said about the MLL, you never rule anything out in the future.
Yeah, and for that Maple Ridge team, we talked about at the beginning of the show, you went on a real tear last summer. You scored, I think it was 103 points in 17 games or something ridiculous. What did you unleash last summer? Obviously, you came off of a great NLL season, but what were you drinking? What was in the water for you?
I don't know. It was just one of those years. You know, everything was clicking, and we had a talented offense in that team, playing with guys like Jared Davis, who's having a pretty good year, obviously in Edmonton this year. Riley Lowen, another guy in Edmonton, having a great rookie season. Benny McIntosh, who's a guy that's, I think he's still at school playing in Drexel for his final year. So, you know, we got some talented pieces up on that offense of Maple Ridge. So they make my life a lot easier. And, you know, we were able to have some success there. Unfortunately, like I said, we weren't able to have success as a team, but, things were clicking for me in the offense. So it was good.
All right. Let's talk about that Calgary offense. When Connor and I were doing our preseason rankings, I was talking about the Roughnecks and especially last season, and saying that I called you guys my league pass team, like my out-of-market team that I really enjoyed watching, and I would seek out your games because you guys played such an exciting, such an up-and-down style, a lot of transition goals, tons of offense. You're still obviously trying to play that style this year, you know, not necessarily having had the same success as last year. And you guys have had some pieces move and change on offense. Talk about where the offense is at. Are you guys happy with what's going on? You know, I know you guys won last week. Talk about, you know, the offensive development and where you guys are going.
Exactly. I think we're getting better every week as we go. We got a guy like Scott Ranger. He's kind of in and out of the lineup this year with work.
Big piece.
Work commitments, who obviously hurts you not having him there. He's a fantastic player. So, I think we're just starting to get in our groove now. But you see guys like Dane Doby, who's, you know, hasn't missed a beat. He's scores about 4 or 5 goals a game. And, he's one of the best, if not the best, finishers in the game. And, a guy like Sean Evans, who quietly puts up 6, 7, 8 assists every game. So, like I said earlier, it's a group of guys that make your life a heck of a lot easier. And, Jeff Schaller, Dell Development, the names go on. So, it's, we got the talent. We got all the talent in the world up there. It's just a matter of putting it together, and I think we've you know, started doing that, especially this past weekend.
Now talk a little bit about your role in the offense. You know, I talked about your scoring this summer, and you know, when you were at Delaware, you put up a ton of points. I talked about the duel in Denver. You're a really prolific goal scorer. Is that something you're conscious about on the floor? And talk about, you know, those opportunities where you kind of try to make your own shot. You know, you're a guy that's known for your dodging ability, being able to fly through the crease, the Superman name. Talk about, you know, finding that balance and knowing how to fit within the offense.
Absolutely. You know, obviously it's no surprise. I'm a guy that loves to have the ball and stick. And but you know, with having the players on our offense like we do, you gotta, you know, learn to share the ball. And you know, everybody wants to have the ball in their stick. So it's just about, you know, pick and choosing the right times to go to the net and when to pull it out and move it to you know, a guy like Sean Evans, Dane Doby, like I was talking about earlier. Obviously they're two guys that know what they're doing with the ball, so you gotta have trust in your fellow teammates. So having a guy like Kurt and Bob McMahon run our offense, to, you know, veteran coaches that you know, really know the game well, and I think they've been doing well, kind of keeping us on leashes and you know, letting us have a little bit of free reign, but at the same time they're putting some structure in. So it's like I said, it's all starting to come together for us. I think we're going to be, you know, putting up some big numbers.
Listen, we've talked about defense, we've talked about offense. I'm kind of interested in hearing a little bit more about the pathway to the NLL for you. And, you know, we often hear from people the benefits of box lacrosse and how they pay off on the field. But I'm interested to hear from you. Do you think there was any benefit from going to play NCAA Division I lacrosse to then go play in the NLL? Is there any benefit to playing field and then going to box?
Well, you know what, one thing off the field, I think putting on some serious muscle, but getting on the training programs that they have at the D1 level. I came in, I was 6'2", about a buck 60 going into university, and I left there at about 200 pounds, so that's one thing that I think definitely helped to grow me into the big body that I am, and being able to compete at the high level of the NLL, playing with all those, you know, bigger bodies out there as well. So I think that's a big thing, and just experience, you know, playing for a guy like Bob Schillinglaw, who's been around the game for 35 years coaching at Delaware. He's obviously, he'll teach you a thing or two. So there's always little things you learn playing the field game. I never, you know, played a lot of field growing up, and like I said, in high school I played a couple years. So there's little things. I think I perfected my underhand shot, which I've utilized in the NLL game as well. So it's little things that I think you pick up from the outdoor game and carry over to the indoor game.
Sure. And, you know, can you talk a little bit more about Coach Schillinglaw? I mean, talk about a lacrosse coaching legend.
Yeah, you golf know, able clap, to, golf clap.
Yeah, right. I mean, consistently able to draw, you know, some really top talent into Delaware, which you wouldn't necessarily think of, you know, state-wise as being a top lacrosse school. So talk about Coach Schillinglaw a little bit. I'm interested to hear your perspective on what it was like playing at Delaware.
Yeah, you know what, Shills is, you don't hold a job for 35 years at the same place for no reason. He, you know, he's just one of the best at what he does, and he knows, you know, he knows the ins and outs of the game like no one else. And being able to recruit guys like, you know, John Grant, obviously, Jordan Hall, he tapped into that Canadian market before, you know, a lot of other teams started doing that. I think obviously helped out a lot. And, you know, I got to give credit to, you know, Coach Greg Carroll as well. He was an assistant there when I was there as a defensive coordinator, and he's another big piece of the puzzle at that school. He's a great great coach and a great recruiter as well. So they got a good program going there, and I think they're going to take some big steps this year, and hopefully the team can do well.
Nice. Yeah, I mean, I think that there's certainly some potential for Delaware. So, you know, maybe you guys pushing a couple developing box players down, maybe strengthen the existing Canadian pipeline.
Yeah, they're always in my ear about you know, future Canadians to get down there from back in BC. So I'm always you know, giving them scouting reports and whatever else. So they're always avidly looking for the new next big thing coming out of Canada.
Was that a hard transition for you, though? I mean, that's a, you know, just geographically, just distance-wise, that's a huge trip. I mean, it must have been a big change. Was that hard?
Yeah, it's definitely not easy going from, you know, being coddled by your parents, having your mom do your laundry and cooking you dinner every night, and then being thrown into an 8x8 dorm prison-type cell with some guy you've never met before. You know,
man, what a great recruiting pitch for Delaware. Sign me up, baby. Blue Hens, let's go.
Oh, it's not just Delaware. I think that's everywhere. But
I was just going to say, you're describing my experience, too.
Yeah. So, but no, it's you know, it's one of those experiences that just definitely helps you grow as a person. And, you know, I'm all the better for it. So it was a ton of fun, and I'd do it all over again in a heartbeat.
Nice. Want to give some shout-outs to our viewers. We had Matt Hawkins before. We got a couple people asking us about our beards. I'm going to keep that a secret, let you know how to do that on your own. You got to figure that out. Heather Adams has an interesting question. She wants to know if you guys if you have any issues with the helmets in the NLL. She wants to know if you want them to be more protective, and are head injuries a concern for you?
I don't think so. I think the helmets they have now are pretty, you know, as good as they've been in a while, the Bauer ones. I don't think there's been a ton of, you know, if many head injuries this year in the league. I don't think it's as prevalent in lacrosse as it is in, you know, football and hockey, the higher speed, you know, higher contact collision sports. So I think, you know, myself and I think anyone that I've talked to is pretty happy with where the, you know, the head protection's at with the league right now.
Sure. Clutch Fanatic, we see you. Thanks for checking in. Here's an interesting one. I assume there's some inside information here. Deanna McCray, who I'm assuming you know, wants to know who is a better 21 player, and I'm guessing Blackjack, him or his girlfriend?
21 might be referring to basketball. That is my girlfriend, actually.
Oh, you and your girlfriend played 21 together.
Oh, yeah. Yeah,
she was
an all-star high school and college basketball player back in her days. So we have some pretty heated games.
Wow!
But I'd say we're pretty even. I think we both beat each other. So I'm not going to give the edge to either one of us.
Good for you for at least giving her some credit. That's pretty good. I mean, I'm competitive in everything. Tiddlywinks, checkers, you name it. I don't know, man. That's good. It must be really good at basketball, though.
Oh yeah, yeah. She holds her own for sure.
Excellent. Josh Errett wants to know, do you do anything special to get pumped up before a game?
Nothing out of the ordinary. Obviously, just listen to music in the room with the boys before the game. You know, tape your stick, cliche. Nothing crazy. Not sitting there beating my chest or drinking 100 Red Bulls or anything. Just pretty mellow, you know, listen to the tunes and get fired up.
Nice. And here's a good one to leave on. You know, take you back to your roots a little bit. You know, we were touching on your upbringing out in British Columbia. Cam Hill is checking in, and he wants to know, what is your greatest memory as a kid playing minor lacrosse in BC?
I'm going to have to say winning provincials in Pee Wee. It's the only year I was able to win a gold medal in the provincials. It was my second year at Pee Wee, and, you know, we beat the island for the gold medal, and then I went on to win bronze, silver my next 4 years in bantam and midget. So a little bit snake bitten, like I told you, going in whether when it comes to the box game. So that's my one shining moment in my box career back when I was about 10 years old in Pee Wee. So
nice, that's good. Hey, and you brought something up that hopefully you can clear up for me and maybe some of our viewers who are not as familiar with Vancouver and some of the geography out there. You referenced the island, and I know that there's some disconnect, you know, in Vancouver between the mainland and the island, and even that seeps into the lacrosse a little bit. Can you talk about that?
Yeah,
which
I mean,
which?
The island is Vancouver Island, obviously. It's the capital of BC, and, you know, they, like when we're in our junior and senior programs, they have Victoria, which is a city on the island, and Nanaimo. They both have their own teams, respectively, and the island's always churned out, you know, top-notch quality talent, guys like Reese Dutch, Jesse King, who's an up-and-comer young kid, you know.
We all got acquainted with him last Saturday, and don't you worry, or last Sunday.
Shamrocks, exactly. Buckeyes.
We know. Yeah, exactly, there you go. The Shamrocks usually try and stick together, the Island boys, so. But no, it's always a good rivalry. You're getting to, you know, take a weekend day, take a ferry or a plane over to the island and make a day trip out of it with the team, so. It's a lot of fun. It's a really nice place. If you ever get a chance to go visit it, I highly recommend it.
Yeah, I've heard nothing but great things about how beautiful it is out west, and I'm sure the experience out. Actually, you know what? Talk about that for a second. Talk about what it's like to go play a game back in Vancouver now. You know, I know you guys have played the stealth one, so you excited to get to the LEC?
It's going to be awesome. You know, always having a ton of family and friends there. We were able to play an exhibition game last year in Langley, which was pretty cool. Same thing, getting to play in front of all of your family and friends. So I think we're there a couple times this year. So getting to play a professional, you know, regular season game in Vancouver, or Langley, I guess, is going to be pretty exciting.
Right, right. Excellent. All right, well, let's transition and talk about the upcoming schedule. Connor, why don't you I know we got one game on the docket for Friday. Why don't you run us through the schedule for week 8 in the NLL?
Yeah, speaking of Vancouver, they are going on the road taking on the Colorado Mammoth in a rematch of last week's last game, which Colorado won 10-9. So, I don't know, Mark, what are you thinking? Can Colorado take 2 in a row over Vancouver?
Yeah, they certainly can. Will they? I don't know. I kind of look at this as the game where Vancouver's got to put their foot in the ground and either turn it around, or they could really sink to the bottom of the Western Conference and maybe stay there. I think that this is a good turning point opportunity for them. Unfortunately, Colorado is not showing signs of weakness right now. Their offense is firing on all cylinders. But maybe, you know, Vancouver can rattle the goalie. You know, they have some rookies that are playing fantastic. Tyler Digby's, you know, probably the front runner for Rookie of the Year right now. What are your thoughts about the game, Connor? Who do you like?
You know, I'm actually going to go with Colorado. And, you know, I think that the stealth playing a game the next day against Calgary, of course, could impact it a little bit. But I'm really looking at the fact that Colorado is taking 2 weeks off. So they don't play another game until March 1st. So I think they don't want to enter a two-week break period, having played 10 games with a 4-6 record. So I think they're really going to make a push to try and get to 5-5.
Yeah, no, that's a great point. And, you know, that time off is really going to help our guest from last week, Adam Jones, recover a little bit. Curtis, what are your thoughts on that game? I know that's in conference for you. Are you guys going to have an eye on that?
Yeah, for sure. Obviously, you're always having an eye on the in-conference games. You know, you look at a team like Vancouver, you know, they're due to break out. They're a good ball club, and you know, they're like a Rochester of the West. They always turn around when it seems to count when it comes to playoff time. So, you know, they're just kind of getting things together, and you know, every team in this league is dangerous in any given weekend. So it's you know, you can never take a game too lightly, and you know, I like their chances against Colorado.
Agreed. Nice. Connor, what do we got coming up on Saturday?
So the next day we got first one up, Edmonton visiting Minnesota. I'll just say right out front, I'm going Edmonton. I don't think it's a shocker that I'm picking them.
No, but hey, it's going to be impressive to see if they can stay undefeated. I didn't think that we would see a team stay undefeated this far into the season, and I certainly didn't think it was going to be Edmonton. So kudos to them if they can keep it up. I think Minnesota's a tough team. Obviously, I loved them at the beginning of the year. They still need to gel, but the problem is their offense is still kind of in flux. They're still trying to figure out their roles and how the offense is going to flow. I know Dane Stevens is a new player that they're counting on, but the problem is that their weakness, the offense that I just talked about, matches up with Edmonton's extreme strength, which is their defense, which we talked about earlier in the show, is league-leading. Curtis, what do you think, man?
For that game?
Yeah.
I'm a big Swarm fan this weekend. Let's just put it that.
Right.
I understand. Okay.
I'm thinking the only way that Minnesota takes that game is if they just, you know, run the ball down the floor every single time and push transition as much as possible. I just don't know that they're going to get it done in the 5-on-5. So it's going to be an interesting game no matter what. Going back to the Eastern Conference, we got another interesting game, Rochester and Toronto. Mark, what are you thinking for this one?
Oh, man, big grudge match. Man, I really like the way Toronto was playing last week on offense, but I can't go against what I talked about before, which is that Rochester defense. I mean, I've really been impressed by the way they've been playing. I think they're going to carry the day here in another really close game. I think both of these teams play that settled half-court-style offense. I don't think we're going to have a barn burner here, but I think we're looking at maybe an 11-10 game. But you got a lot of guys that are really familiar with each other, so this one might get a little chippy.
Yeah, I mean, I think you might be looking at even a couple less goals than that scored. Just the way that the Rochester defense plays, how they extend out, get in passing lanes, they're really disruptive. And I think they're a little physical. So it really depends how Toronto comes out. If they come out looking for a fight, you could see some goals scored. If they come out, playing looking to pass the ball, it could be a rough start for them.
Right. And what was I saying, 11-10? It's probably going to be more like 6-5, right? Something like that, you think?
I think that's possible.
Curtis, what do you think about these two teams tangling this weekend?
Is the game in Toronto or is it in Rochester?
It's in Toronto at the Air Canada Centre.
Well, saying that, I think I like Toronto. Toronto's been playing well at home, obviously. They spanked us early in the year and spanked Philly last weekend. So, it's a guy like Billings, GB's playing real well right now.
Sure.
He's a tough player to stop once he gets rolling. So, obviously you got to love the Rochester defense, and Vino and Net has been lights out. But I'm going to give the edge to Toronto and say I'll agree with about an 11-10 score.
Look at you going with another British Columbia guy. Nice. Nice. That's good.
We've got Philly visiting Buffalo, 7:30 p.m. First Niagara Center. Should be a good one. Bandits fans have been coming out, I think, supporting the team pretty well. I'm personally liking Buffalo. I like them to kind of get back on the winning track. I'm taking the Bandits over visiting Philly.
Agreed. I mean, there's no way I'm picking against my Bandits, and I think that they have revenge on their mind. Remember that Philly came out first game of the season and surprised all of us, I think, in beating the Bandits and beating them pretty handily. The Bandits have rebounded nicely since that loss. They've really been playing some great lacrosse, and I think they certainly have revenge on their mind. We talked about Philly at the beginning of the show. They lost two games last week. Like I said, I was impressed by the way they played, even in the losses, but I think Buffalo is going to be a little too much for them in a resurgent effort. Curtis, anything to add on this game? You got anybody you like here?
No, I think you guys pretty much nailed it on the head there. Obviously, the Buffalo we saw last year isn't the true Bandits team. They're a great team, and they've showed it this year, and they're winning games. And nothing against Philly; they've been playing well this year too. And I don't think it's going to be a blow by any means. They've been staying in games. Aside from, obviously, the game against Philly last week, but they gave Edmonton all they could handle a day after getting blown out, which shows a lot of character. So, but I do like Buffalo at home.
Yeah, I think it's going to be a close one, too, though. I agree.
And then we get to the last but not least game of the week, Vancouver visiting Calgary. Curtis, I'd ask you what you think, but I think you're going to go with the Roughnecks.
To the Dome.
Yeah, man. Scotiabank Saddle Dome playing host to what I think should be a really good game. I'm looking forward to you guys doing some battle out there. I actually do like Calgary to win this game. Mark, what are you thinking? You in agreement here? Are you going to show out on our guest? Pick Vancouver. What's going to happen?
I'm not. I think if Vancouver's going to win a game this weekend, I think it's going to be their first contest on Friday night. I like them better in that game against Colorado. Like I said before, I like the way Calgary plays. I think their up-and-down style will play really well against Vancouver's kind of injured defense right now. Hey, Curtis, quick question for you. Who needs to go off this weekend? Who's a guy that you guys need to get going on offense and maybe start the fires a little bit more? I know Daryl Veltman's been coming on a little bit of late.
Yeah, Veltz is a guy. I think Shawny Evans is going to have a big night. He's going to have 4 or 5 goals. He's been putting up the assists and setting everybody else up.
Yeah.
I think he's due for a big goal output, so I'm calling that one.
Can't argue with that.
That's a good call. Evans, once again, MVP candidate. He had a great season last year. Like Curtis was just saying, he's really been dishing out the assists. Hopefully he can start to put some goals up on the board. We'll see how it goes. Connor, any final thoughts on the game out west to finish us off?
No, I think it's just another good one. You got a lot of parity this year, a lot of close games, but I think we're starting to see we're really kind of reaching that halfway point where you're starting to see a little distance appear, and I say appear because I think that that's important. Once teams make it in the playoffs, all these bets are kind of off. So, it's been a really good season so far. I've been having a lot of fun watching, And I'm looking forward, you know, five more great games this weekend. Can't complain about that.
No, certainly. And reminder to everybody, catch the great lacrosse action on the Lacrosse Network. You can catch the games both live when they happen and then in replay during the week. They're there all the time on YouTube. Also, be sure to check out the top 10 plays of the week. And please get your questions in early for us next week at hashtag NLL Live. I'd like to thank our guest, Curtis Dixon. Curtis, you got any shout-outs to the people at home? I'm sure Deanna is anxious for Valentine's Day tomorrow. any big plans?
Oh, no, we got practice tomorrow night, so.
Oh, saved by the bell, huh?
Yeah, I guess you could say that, yeah.
Okay.
Oh, nothing so crazy. Mom, dad, aunt, and grandma, I don't know if you guys are watching, but say hi to everyone back home, and hopefully everyone's doing well.
Nice. Yeah, and thank you to all the viewers checking in tonight, especially Nick Rose and Mark Matthews. Nice to know that the rest of the league is paying attention, want to know what everybody's up to. That'll do it for us this week on NLL Live for Week 8. Looking forward to see how the games turn out. We'll be with you next week, Thursday night, 8 o'clock, where we're always at. Actually, you know what? Find us at 8:15 next Thursday night. We seem to be coming on a little late, so let's just make the move to 8:15 Thursday night. You'll see us here on the Lacrosse Network for another great edition of NLL Live. That's all, everybody.